But first, the big picture impact on the Obama presidency of the health care reform victory. And we get the takes of four trained observers who are familiar to NewsHour viewers, historians Ellen Fitzpatrick of the University of New Hampshire and Richard Norton Smith of George Mason University, Clarence Page, a syndicated columnist for the Chicago Tribune, and Michael Gerson, former speechwriter for President George W. Bush, now a syndicated columnist for the Washington Post. Richard, how important to the Barack Obama presidency was getting this thing done?
It was of defining importance. Think of the conversation we would be having if they had lost this vote by a couple votes. Not only was it important, it not only changes the perceptions in this town, it overnight changed the conventional wisdom in this town that 2 months ago not only was health care reform dead in the water, but quite possibly the Obama presidency itself. And so by winning and how he won, there's been a lot of talk about how he won because he persevered. There's more to it than that. He actually, if he had persevered in what wasn't working, again, we wouldn't be having this conversation. He took control of the bill, not just the debate, trying to frame the debate. On February 22nd, the White House put out, this is what we want to be, is the bill. In effect, taking it away from Congress, taking it out of process, and reestablishing his own reputation as a leader. And 3 days later, you had the bipartisan meeting at Blair House, which, whether you think it was bipartisan or not, to most people who watched, at least was as an example of what they say they want, a president to listen to the opposition. And then finally, the insider. He had a Reagan-esque ability to keep attention focused on the issue, even after we wanted to change the subject. And at the end, he had a Johnsonian ability to cut deals, apply pressure, and get across the finish line.
How do you see it, Michael?
Well, I agree. I think it puts him in a very select company, kind of the pantheon of the progressive presidents, people that made a big difference on the role of government in American life, people like Wilson and FDR and Lyndon Johnson. Now, some of those presidents were politically successful, like FDR. Some of them were not so successful, Wilson and LBJ. But all of them did something extraordinary. They tested the limits of executive power. And they became figures that inspired both love and resentment over generations. So I think that Barack Obama now belongs in that company, whether you like what he did or not.
Do you agree with Richard's kind of how much was at risk here for the presidency of Barack Obama if it had gone the other way?
Well, having served some time in the White House, the main determination that the press and the public make about the president is not really liberal or conservative. It's strong or weak. If the president had appeared weak, it's a hard narrative to change over time. So I think once he embarked on this strategy, which I'm not sure was the best strategy for him, he lost a lot of support over time. But I think he would have been wiser to take on economic growth and job creation, which were really much larger public priorities. But once he embarked on this course, he couldn't back off of this course. And I think he needed to do what he did.
Ellen, what's your reading here?
I agree with everyone who's spoken that this is extremely significant historically. When Lyndon Johnson signed the Medicare legislation in 1965, he went to Independence, Missouri to sign it in the presence of Harry Truman. And he made the comment that people didn't vote and love Harry Truman because he promised to give the American people hell. It was because he gave them hope. And what Obama had promised in this campaign was sweeping change in the health care system. He delivered on helping to create a very big piece of legislation that moves the country in a direction that is probably the most significant legislative change in the system since the creation of Medicare.
What about Michael's point that he went from being seen as a weak president to being a strong president just because this thing passed?
I think it gave enormous amount of wind in his sails. He has enormous challenges to face, however, and it is going to be the record of his administration will be measured by more than simply this fulfilled promise. there are many other problems that will need to be addressed, obviously.
Clarence, do you buy the idea that President Obama actually changed his style of governing? Or was he always this way, and it, people just finally figured it out?
I don't think he changed his style. I think steady course that Colin Powell described late in the Obama campaign was what we saw here. Even while many around him, critics on the right, left, and middle, were backseat driving over how he ought to handle health care. I agree with Michael in retrospect that he might have done better or had fewer problems if he had gone after jobs first. There were a lot of folks who were saying that. There were people who were saying, break it up into smaller bite-sized bits. Don't try to comprehensive health care. I was one of those people, because it looked like it was all going to collapse and all. And I will confess that he proved me wrong because he got it through. And it was an internal debate at the White House, as we know, between Rahm Emanuel apparently saying that more pragmatic view, Nancy Pelosi over on Capitol Hill saying, no, go for it. He decided to go for it so that not only did he get the bill passed, but he got the big package passed, the whole enchilada. So that gives him more of a sense of really changing history, the biggest shift on health care policy since Medicare, and the kind of momentum now that enables him to do more in his second year.
Changing history? Do you buy that phrase, Richard?
Yeah, it's changing history in this sense. None of us know how this is going to pan out. None of us know the short-term political consequences. But consider this. For 40 years in this country, Nixon, Reagan, Gingrich, the Republican Congress, Bill Clinton saying the era of big government is over. For 40 years in this country, there was a consensus which might be seen as a reaction against the Great Society. The notion that government was overreaching, tried to do too much, intruding in our lives, even with the best of intentions. So Barack Obama not only brought about a historic expansion of that government, he did it in a political climate and a cultural climate much more hostile than the one Lyndon Johnson operated in mm-hmm. in the mid-60s.
But what Michael, the president himself said in an interview this morning on NBC, mm-hmm. that he rejected the idea that this is a radical change, that this health care bill in any way constitutes a radical step, that it's a moderate, he said, he called it a moderate bill in the middle, and that it should not be seen as some kind of big liberal thing.
Oh, I agree with that. I think if you look at this...
You do agree with it.
Well, no, I agree that that's his argument.
Oh, he's right.
I think that you would find that FDR made similar arguments about Social Security and other things. These aren't radical departures. This is not socialism, all these sort of things. So I think if the president has an interest in making this case. But I think there's an interesting battle of historical narratives going on. I think that a lot of Democrats hope this is like FDR and Social Security. It becomes an assumption of American life, a great bipartisan commitment of American government. I think Republicans view it more in the context of LBJ and the war on poverty, okay, mm-hmm. which was eventually viewed as a very well-intentioned but deeply flawed public policy approach that was repudiated in large part by his successors, including Republicans and Democrats like Bill Clinton. Republicans, I think, view it more in that category. As the historians will say, we shall see.
Yeah. You're a we shall see person on this issue, Ellen, as to what kind of history was made here?
I do think it's very, very significant. And, the critics of the war on poverty have said that it was declared and never fought. In this case, and in the case of Social Security, these are fundamental legislative changes. This legislation, this bill, it will be changed, it will be altered as Social Security was, but I don't think it's going to be undone myself. And in that sense, it is a redistributive program of enormous significance. It will be tinkered with. It will be changed. It's not going to look this way 20 years from now, even 10 years, 5 years from now. But I do think it is a move in a direction that progressive reformers have been seeking for well over 100 years. And this is indeed a significant moment.
So you would agree with Michael that this is, in fact, a radical departure in government. This is not something in the middle, as President Obama characterized it today.
No, I don't see it as a radical departure in government. We don't have a single-payer system. We don't have the kind of reform that those on the left or liberals who see Barack Obama as too moderate would have advocated. Mm-hmm. It's much less than what many sought. I don't see anything radical about it in that sense.
Clarence?
Well, he brought a bonanza to the insurance industry, for example. I mean, this is a very pro-private sector kind of a plan. It's not single payer. It's not public option. It is exchanges, which this is a compromise, much like Lyndon Johnson had to compromise on his initial goals with Medicare to please the AMA, the insurance company, various interests. It's still something has to be done about the cost savings because the bad news has to come down the road here insofar as paying for all this, but it's going to happen.
Finally, I want to pick up on what you said, Richard, about the climate in which this happened. The president also spoke today about this. He called it the current culture in Washington. He said it feeds the extreme sides and essentially widens instead of narrows differences and moves toward consensus. You think it's any worse now than it normally is?
I do think it's worse. I think there are a number of factors contributing to it, including, on balance, the internet and cable TV. I mean, journalism has been redefined in many quarters as away from the healthy adversarial relationship of yore to, you know, the Friday night fights 24/7. And I think that's contributed to the ferocity. You see it up on the Hill, the lack of collegiality, the lack of personal relationships that contribute in part to the difficulty of passing anything, let alone something as big as this.
Where do you come down on that, Michael? Did Barack Obama get this done in an unusually difficult climate, in your opinion?
Well, I think it was a fairly difficult climate. But, you know, Barack Obama campaigned on two contradictory goals. One of them is he was going to be the great national healer, a postpartisan president. The other one is he was going to be an agent of change and going to solve important problems. In this, after the Massachusetts victory, the Senate victory for Republicans, he had a choice to make. Am I going to go an incremental approach? Am I going to be the healer, or am I going to be the agent of change? He chose to be the agent of change. He actually chose to be both divisive and consequential. So I don't think these ideological divisions are just in the air. I think he chose, like many presidents, to make that kind of difference for his ideological perspective that's going to make him very, very controversial for years to come.
In a word, you agree with that, Ellen, that analysis? He made a conscious decision to do this, and he knew exactly what he was doing?
I do, but I don't see any contradiction between a president who is healing and bringing about change. Some of our greatest presidents have attempted to do both and earn their place in the pantheon of great presidents for pursuing precisely those tacks. And so I don't see in any way that these are contradictory.
Clarence, you see them contradictory?
Well, let's remember that health care was a core issue of his campaign. War and the economy were thrust upon him, but he always campaigned for getting health care, so that's a leading issue. So I think that's why he was willing to go to the mattresses for this. Immigration, education, other issues down the line, I think hopefully we will see some more comity again. But we are in a very divisive time.
As we say in journalism, we shall see.
We shall see.
We shall see. Ellen, gentlemen, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.